You know when your customers are shopping at your business and they pick up a product? The customer holds it, feels it, and shows it to their friend. Then they look at the price tag.
Oh my, I need to look at something else.
The customer picks up a second item and loves the way it looks. They've heard of this product, but haven't yet seen it in person.
I've got to have this!
You're happy the customer chose to buy a product, but you're equally frustrated that they didn't buy both items.
I want them both.
The Consumer Experience Lab at Barbera Solutions designs behavioral strategies that target the consumer's decision-making process. BarberaSolutions.com. Because the opposite of rational is not irrational. B-A-R-B-E-R-A Solutions.com. Why is the shopping cart always in the top right of the screen?
How do companies predict my purchases?
Why do prices end in 9?
Why do fast food companies use red and yellow in their logos?
Why do restaurants always have one expensive menu item?
Researchers, marketers, and very curious people seek the answers for how we make decisions and how we choose products. ClickSuasion finds the secrets that companies use and shares them with you.
Why do I feel better when I bought the last remaining airline ticket?
How do I make choices based on colors and fonts?
Welcome to ClickSuasion. This is your host, Michael Barbera. Today we're going to discuss anchoring consumer choice on non-traditional menus. Well, we're going to talk about food, so who doesn't like food? I love food, so but I won't eat while I talk. That would be rude. So the food service industry is volatile due to the low barrier to entry and the high level of competition and significantly low profit margins. You know, food service operators are likely to reduce expenditures and save money wherever possible. Food service operators are also known for being creative to attain an advantage on the competition. Designing menus that are less taxing on the consumer's choice are a common approach to increasing revenue and enhancing the consumer experience. Furthermore, unique menus are likely to attribute to an improved consumer experience that carries an intangible value of word-of-mouth marketing between consumers. So approximately 40% of North Americans eat at least one meal a day away from home. Yet most colonial Americans never dined in a restaurant. Colonial Americans did eat away from home during church, socials, funerals, weddings, and other special occasions. As early as the late 17th century, colonial Americans began to frequent taverns, inns, and boarding houses. Ironically, at this time, these establishments were required by law to offer meals for sale to travelers and workers that were away from home. The requirement to offer food for sale meant the need for having a list of items for sale, hence the menu was born. Although the menu has changed in appearance and format since Delmonico's in the late 1800s, the menu continues to serve the same purpose, to be the best marketing document. And here's why. The menu is nearly guaranteed to be read by every patron. Best Buy, Walmart, and Target cannot claim that every customer reads a list of each product for sale in their establishment. Non-traditional menus such as the chalkboard and tablets are growing in popularity throughout the United States. There's a significant amount of research that suggests anchoring menu items and prices entice the consumer to make a choice that best aligns with the restaurant's profit margin. As technology changes our behavior and how individuals choose to engage with brands, restaurants have proven to change their approach to the consumer experience. It is common to visit restaurants that use tablets for menus or provide a tablet with each seat at the restaurant to keep the consumer occupied. Think about your last trip to a major airport. Additionally, there is research that suggests table turnover times have decreased at such restaurants, which is likely to affect revenue for the restaurant and income for servers who rely on tips for compensation. So we developed some research, and here's the two research questions. RQ number one, what are the effects of consumer choice when choosing food and beverage from a non-traditional menu? Research question number two, what are the changes of restaurant revenue when offering the consumer a non-traditional menu? Hypothesis number one, participants will choose a higher quantity of food items when offered a non-traditional menu. Hypothesis number two, restaurants will experience an increase in the median amount of each bill when participants are offered a non-traditional menu. So the research was a non-field study in a controlled environment The restaurant was fictitious in a lab environment. No brand names were used. The time of day was 11:30 a.m. through 2 p.m., and participants who consumed food within 2 hours of the study were removed from the study. No comparison is designed to anchor from prior meals or future planned meals, for example, dinner reservations that evening. There could be an infinite number of variables for the research, but the research was not able to test each potential variable for validity purposes, so we encourage other researchers to expand this research in the future. The definition of non-traditional menus are non-paper, non-verbal menus at restaurants that offer in-house seating and wait service. Prices were removed from the menu items. So we had four experimental groups. Experimental group number one viewed a chalkboard item. Research group number one was offered 5 food and beverage choices. The second group viewed a digital menu on a tablet and was offered 22 menu and beverage items. Experimental group number three, I can't talk today, viewed a 5x7 cardstock menu that consisted of the same five food and beverage items as research group number one. And research group number four viewed a trifold laminated paper menu that consisted of the same food and beverage items as research group number two. Research groups one and three shared the same food and beverage prices. Research groups two and four also shared the same food and beverage prices as one another. The participants consisted of 590 undergraduate students at a university in the United States. Each student received additional course credit for participating in the research. A total of 610 participants were recruited. However, 20 were later eliminated for consumption of food within 2 hours of the research. I don't blame them. I would have ate too. Age and socioeconomic status were not collected or measured for this research. Although age and socioeconomic status were not collected, it is likely that the majority of participants could be categorized into similar segments of the population. It is likely that the results of this research will reflect the behaviors of the food choices often made by the participants in the study. Each participant in group number one were seated in the restaurant environment. The participant was seated alone and was instructed to make a food and beverage choice from a chalkboard menu on the wall. Prices were not included on the menu. Prices were withheld to avoid consumer self-anchoring of external variables that were not collected or measured during this experiment. Following the completion of group number one, the median cost of the chosen meal was $16.62. Total population of that group was 140 participants. There were no outliers in this data set. The standard deviation for the experiment was $4.41, and the majority of participants chose the two menu items at the top of the chalkboard. 64% of participants chose the second option, and 23% chose the second option. Following the completion of group number two, the median cost of the chosen meal was $12.31 from a total number of 162 participants. There were 22 menu choices in group two, 17 more than group number one. Group two chose their menu items from a tablet. The majority of participant choices were derived from the lower third of the menu. Therefore, the participant was forced to scroll downward with their finger to view the lower third of the page. There were a total of 404 menu choices made during the experiment with group two. 41% of menu choices were chosen from the lower third of the page, which were outside of the digital margin of the tablet. So let's talk about group three. Group three participants, which were 139 participants, viewed the 5x7-inch cardstock menu. The menu that was presented to group three consisted of the same five items as group one. The participants' menu choices during this experiment were significantly different than group one. Group three's participants mostly chose items that were towards the bottom of the 5x7 cardstock menu. Additionally, the menu item that was chosen most frequently consisted of more characters than all other choices. Therefore, the name of the menu item printed further right than other menu choices. The participant choice of this menu item is consistent with earlier human eye tracking research with menu choices, and the median cost of participant choice The median cost of participants' choice in this experiment was $9.81 from and participants in group three chose less items per person than all other groups. The last experimental group, group number four, consisted of 149 participants that viewed a tri-fold laminated paper menu, think Applebee's, that consisted of the same food and beverage items as research group number two. So consistent with prior human eye tracking research, the majority of participants chose menu items that were placed in the top right of the trifold. 54% of participants chose at least one item in the top right of the trifold menu, and the median cost per participant throughout the entire trifold menu was $19.04. The median cost of menu items chosen from the top right of the trifold were $22.61. So it's likely that non-traditional menus enticed creativity and innovation, which allowed the participant to have the freedom with their choices. As suggested from the research in group number one, the chalkboard menu, which yielded the second highest median menu choices per person, only to fall short of the traditional trifold menu used in group number four, which yielded a significant $22.61 median cost per person. Research groups 2 and 3 didn't yield a higher cost. However, each suggests that menu item placement is likely to affect the consumer's choice through anchoring. The saliency of the menu is likely to affect the menu choices and the median dollar amount per person. Group 3 was offered a menu on 5x7-inch cardstock, and the cardstock is likely to reflect lack of effort in the menu design, which is likely perceived, or we attribute that to perceived as lack of effort in food preparation and taste. So choices may differ when there is another person present at the point of decision. There could be an infinite number of variables for this research. The research team was not able to test each potential variable for validity purposes. However, we encourage other researchers to expand this research in the future. We will continue to expand this research as well. The research conducted during these experiments confirms the cognitive tax of anchoring and its effect on consumer choice. Consumers are likely to change their decisions based upon the delivery and the presentation of a menu. Moreover, consumers are likely to differ in the amount of money spent per restaurant visit because of the variables other than taste and hunger. Thanks for listening to Clicksuasion. Again, this is Michael Barbera, your host. Go ahead and subscribe to Clicksuasion wherever you listen to your podcasts, and we'll let you know when the next podcast is available.
You know when your customers are shopping at your business and they pick up a product? The customer holds it, feels it, and shows it to their friend. Then they look at the price tag.
Oh my, I need to look at something else.
The customer picks up a second item and loves the way it looks. They've heard of this product, but haven't yet seen it in person.
I've got to have this!
You're happy the customer chose to buy a product, but you're equally frustrated that they didn't buy both items.
I want them both.
The Consumer Experience Lab at Barbera Solutions designs behavioral strategies that target the consumer's decision-making process. BarberaSolutions.com. Because the opposite of rational is not irrational. BarberaSolutions.com. Thanks for listening to Clicksuasion. Subscribe to the podcast, read our research, and get in touch with us at Clicksuasion.com. You can also find us on Twitter with the handle @Clicksuasion.